We're grateful for all of you that have come out tonight. We appreciate your love of the truth. We welcome those of you on live stream also who join us in these gatherings. This is our continuation of our series on the New Covenant. This would be message 18. The reality of the new makes the former old. It's a very important truth we're ministering here tonight.
Yeah. Amen.
The reality of the new covenant makes the old covenant old. Now, there, as you must know, there exists a phenomenal amount of ignorance concerning the new covenant, new and old covenants. Even though considerable explanation is given in Scripture on this subject, it remains a very dark and hazy subject. Some feel that the new covenant is like the old covenant, just has different requirements. It's a new set of guidelines, new set of commandments. Others teach that the promises that were issued under the old covenant actually transfer over to the new covenant. So if you've ever been exposed to the media moguls, they consistently quote from Deuteronomy 28, which are promises of the old covenant, and say that these are realized in Christ. You'll be the head, not the tail, and you'll lend and not borrow, and blessed in the field and blessed in the city, and so forth. May make sense, but these do not transfer over.
Yes, that's right.
Dangerous to teach this, because the reality of it is they are not transferred over, and that there are no Christians that I know of, or body of Christians, that always have sufficient earthly resources and big families. See, people ought to be able to figure this out, but they aren't, because they're led astray by people. Some feel that life under the new covenant really consists of rules and procedures, and it's just a new set of guidelines of how to live.
Yeah.
So we hear things about the Bible being a road map to heaven and things like this. But the new covenant is precisely that. It's a new covenant. New meaning not new like new car or new suit or new earrings. It's a new kind of covenant. Everything's of the same order. You can't distinguish one thing from another. If it's old, you can't, like, start again. The new covenant isn't like just starting over again with a few more assets and a few more benefits. It's a new kind of covenant.
That's right.
It's a new basis for acceptance.
Yeah.
Under the old covenant, you either did everything God said without any deviation ever in your entire lifetime. You were allowed zero mistakes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You wonder about this, that Adam and Eve can correct you in the day of judgment. One. That's what they did. One sin. That's all they did. One.
Yeah.
Moses, so far as we know, committed, as far as the records concerned, committed one sin. God said, speak to the rock and it'll bring forth water, and he hit it, and that excluded him from the promised land.
Yeah.
One.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That after 120 years of life.
Mm.
So there, under the old covenant, you either did everything or your life didn't count.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So far as being accepted by God was concerned.
Yeah.
So there has to be a new basis. If our salvation depends on perfect compliance with what God said, we're not going to make it.
Yeah, right.
And you should learn that, like, by the time you're six. That should kind of begin to, and then it's from then on, it should become more and more crystal clear that you can't even go a day without doing something you've got to ask forgiveness
that's
for.
That's right,
man. All right, so that can't be the basis for your acceptance, because right. God is righteous. God is unwavering.
Yeah. Amen.
He can't say, I'm willing to overlook that. Mm. That's when God appeared to be overlooking sin, Paul said in Acts 17 that he was winking.
Yeah.
Well, that's to accommodate us.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He knew what was happening, but he didn't bring the hammer down on him until Christ came.
Yeah.
Then that's another story.
Yeah. Amen.
You see, I mean, he'll punish you. He gives you an outlet. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you don't, and you'll be able to trace this through your life when the hammer came down.
Yeah.
If you look back, I'm talking about after you in Christ. If you look back, you'll find out that when you didn't conduct yourself rightly and you failed to confess it to God, you paid some penalty.
That's right.
Amen.
Now remember, I'm saying there's a new basis for acceptance other than perfect compliance. Now, the point I want to establish here, first of all, that the old covenant promoted bondage.
Yeah.
People who promote rules are promoting slavery to sin. That's the point I want to make here. This point is made now in Scripture. This is not like a conclusion of mine that I've reached. Let me say it again. That if you live by rules, if you have to be told what to do all the time, and you have to be told what not to do all the time, and you live your life that way, it will enslave you to sin. That ought to open up. You know, some people, that should open up what's been going on. All right, here's the, Paul talks about this in the book of Galatians. In the book of Galatians, these people genuinely had believed.
Mm-hmm.
And they did at first they did a good job. Paul said they ran well. I mean, they lived with taking advantage of the covenantal benefits, and they did well. But somebody come along and taught them old covenant ways. They focused on circumcision, which was a sign and seal of the covenant made with Abraham and under the law also. And here's some things he said, Galatians 2:4. These people promise liberty to, if you just are all circumcised, everything will be all right. Of course, they didn't point out that only the men were circumcised. They forgot to they omitted that little technicality.
Yeah.
Galatians 2:4. Because of false brethren unawares brought in, who came in privily or privately to spy out our liberty, which we have in Jesus Christ, that they might bring us into bondage.
Yeah.
So they'd come together to discuss the matter of circumcision, which wasn't clear to the early leaders, including apostles. The subject hadn't been cleared up yet. And some people came in to plead the cause for circumcision. Paul and elsewhere called it spied out their liberty.
Yeah.
They tried to make them change the reason they were serving God. One is you do it from your heart because you believe. The other is you do it because you have to. That's two different ways.
Yeah.
And they did it, Paul said, to bring you into bondage.
Yeah,
it looked like it was more discipline. Now some people say, here's the secret. If you fast, that's the secret. If you fast, see, that's promoting bondage. I'm going to tell you, if you live like that, you'll sin more, not less.
Yeah.
I know for some people this doesn't sound right, but I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
This is the way it is. You don't live by fasting. You don't live by praying.
Yeah.
This is not how you live. You don't live by going out and doing some good thing for your neighbor. This is not what gives you life.
Amen.
We're not saying those things are wrong. We're saying that's not the they're not a basis for God accepting you, because there are people in the world that do a whole lot to help people. Flood relief and earthquake relief and the Red Cross and the United Way, and they're doing a lot to help people. But it's not registered in heaven so far as their personal acceptance by God is concerned. Here's another text. Galatians 4:3 goes back to when people were under the law. Even so we, when we were children, let me speak a bit vulgarly here, when we were dumb, we didn't know what to do. Mommy and daddy had to tell us what to do, what not to do, because we were ignorant. That's just the way children are. I mean, it's this. It doesn't mean this is wrong. This is just the way children are. Turn your children out to be raised like the wolves, and guess what you're going to get? When we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. The elements is the ABCs. If you were talking about raising children, say, don't go in the street. If you see a dog foaming at the mouth and barking at you, don't go over and pet it.
Yeah,
at some point, you got to learn that you have to do these things without being told. I mean, if we had to really take one of our children, hold their hand every time they cross the street, we know they got had some kind of major problem. But there are some professed Christians that are being taught that they don't make themselves accountable to somebody, so they hold their hand. So when they travel, they can hold their hand so they make sure they don't watch an X-rated movie on the TV when they're away. If this is how you live, you become a slave to sin.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Then the desire to sin will flame up more.
Yes, amen.
Because this is the way human nature is apart from Christ. If you tell the flesh don't do it, the flesh says, I want to do it.
Yeah,
that's right. Yeah, that's right. It's Brother Boyce Moulton that cited this illustration several years ago at a renewal. He said if you brought people together and said, look, don't think about lemon pie. Don't do it. Now, to help us, we're going to, don't think about lemon pie. Don't see, we'll sing these songs to help. Well, what do you do? He gave that about 10 years ago, and I still remember that. That's how flesh is. See, that's how out of Christ life is. When you say don't, the flesh says, that's what I'll do. Here's another verse. Elements of the world, the ABCs, but rudiment, how children are taught. Galatians 4:9. Now, after that ye have known God, known God. See, that's a whole lot different than known the rules. This is all. After ye have known God, or rather are known of God, that is where really is God knowing you is what made the difference. How turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto ye desire again to be in bonds? How come you're going back to rule keeping? After you tasted of the Lord and you were doing things because you wanted to do them, you were pleasing God because you were satisfied when you did, you're pleasing God because you received benefits when you did. Why? See, this was completely unreasonable. When you went back to chains. You walk back into prison. You are sitting in the cell again. Remember, my point is that living by rules enslaves. It doesn't liberate.
Yeah, that's right.
And if you have to be strong to do this, but if you will turn to a Christian channel, TV, expose yourself, just do it for one day. you will almost fall over with how much of this kind of stuff is being taught. People saying, here's a list of rules. This is what you do. This is the secret. Wisdom is the principal thing. That's what Solomon said. That's what's being promoted now. Wisdom is the principal thing. And when it comes to living, one of the dumbest men in the world was Solomon. The older he got, the dumber he got. He ended up promoting idolatry and the burning of children to Baal and building idol houses for his wives. This is Solomon, the one who wrote Proverbs. See, so Proverbs won't save you. It won't. It does. It's not that it's wrong. It's that this is baby talk. This is lisping. This is not profound stuff. Solomon, who didn't even mention the word eternal. Now, this isn't condemning Solomon. God gave Solomon all the wisdom you could get in this world without ever going to school.
That's right.
Amen.
He was an expert in botany and horses and biology, and he knew all of that. All the stuff that people learn, God gave it all to him, but it wasn't enough to check lust.
That's right. Yeah. Amen.
It wasn't enough to stop him from getting drunk.
That's right.
Or from marrying 700 wives and 1,000 concubines. 300 wives and 700 concubines. It wasn't enough. Even though the rules were, they were clear, but and God did this to teach us something. He teaches us this isn't the way to please me, and I'm going to give one. I won't. You. Nobody has to learn this, brother, the hard way.
Amen.
God gave us an example, and I think He will. I think He will compensate Solomon for taking the brunt of that. But he gave us Solomon to show you can end up doing everything Solomon said without ever reading the book of Proverbs. If you have life from God, this is how you'll live. And when you read Proverbs and saying, God, land, that's what I got to do. You'll read it and say, that's what I've been doing. That's the difference. So it was unreasonable, Paul said, how come you're going back to what enslaves you to sin when you once were freed from it? See, there's a recalcitrant spirit. That's a spirit that's got to be harnessed. It's a horse that's got to be bridled. This horse is not going to just happily carry you along. You've got to put a bit and a bridle in its mouth, or it'll go its way, not your way. A recalcitrant spirit can't be corrected by law.
Amen.
I've had 10 children and raised one extra. So in a sense, I'm an expert on children. I can tell you that you can teach them all the same way and they don't all end up the same way. Sometimes one of them bottom out. It's like it hurts, but you sense there's really nothing you can do about it by saying, now look, here's what I didn't teach you, I'm going to teach you now. You can't correct it that way. If none of your children have, you just give God thanks. It isn't because you set the right guidelines. That's not why. It's because you taught the right truth. So that when they became of age, they knew what it was to have faith and trust in Christ. That was a secret. Not having rules.
Amen.
The law awakened sin. Sin was like in a state of innocence. Sin was like a sleep. As soon as the law came, it woke it up. Romans 7, 9, and 10, Paul expresses this, and he's speaking about his life prior to being in Christ. He says, I was alive without the law once. That is, I thought I was doing pretty good. I was serving God. When I persecuted the church, I did it because I thought these people were wrong. So I was doing what Moses said to do. Moses said, take their life. If someone teaches another God, you take their life. You terminate their influence. That's what Moses said to do.
Yeah, that's right.
So he thought that's what he was doing. Mm-hmm. But it was against the truth. When I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, then he tells you what commandment was, thou shalt not covet. When the commandment came, we'd say when the commandment came home to me.
Yeah.
When I realized what the commandment said, when it said, thou shalt not covet, don't desire what's wrong. Uh-huh. When the commandment came, sin revived, and I died. What do you mean? The sinful nature, as soon as you tell the sinful nature what not to do, it wakes up.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Like Samson woke up and shakes itself to do what's wrong. See, that's what law does to a person.
Yeah.
This is why a lot of sin exists in the church. This is one reason why.
Uh-huh.
And because people have, their sermons have woke sin up rather than promoting faith.
Yeah.
So whoever preaches rules and procedures and methodologies, they're waking sin up.
Yeah.
Because God didn't make man. You can't govern a sinful nature. You gotta slay it.
Amen.
You have to crucify it.
Amen.
You have to put it on the cross.
That's right.
That's what has to be done.
Uh-huh.
Now Israel under divine direction proved that reform cannot be achieved through the law. See that? They proved that. You've got a history of 1,500 years, 1,500 years of history. All kind of reminders from God, prophets sent from God, warnings sent from God, chastenings from God, death administered by God, famines coming from God, foreign countries defeated him, in slavery to foreign countries, and it never could correct their wayward lives. So they proved, they lived it out. Now we shouldn't have to theorize about this. He set Israel as an example. There it is right before you, an entire nation, a holy law, a spiritual law, a good law that came from God. There was nothing wrong with the law.
Amen.
What was wrong is man can't be governed by law. Well, the only way he can is you have to kill the person.
Yeah.
That's the only way. Under the law is what you had to do. Actually, it's what it's done now. The only way you can stop the outbreak of sin is you got to mortify your members that are upon the earth. Mortify means to kill them. You've got to mortify. You've got to, by the Spirit, you've got to slay the old nature. The slaying is done by crucifixion. You can't just take a spear and run it through, and that's the end of it. That's not the way death is accomplished under the economy of Christ. And the reason is, man has to establish that you live by faith. You don't live by killing. You live by faith, see, by trust in God. And in order for faith to flourish, you've got to pinion the old man on the cross. In other words, you have to reject its appeals. And the grace of God teaches you how to do that. Teaches you how to deny or reject ungodliness and worldly lust. See, it teaches you how to do that because the flesh can't do anything while it's on the cross.
Yes.
Just like that thief, two thieves were crucified with Christ, one on either side. One thief repented, one thief didn't, and the thief that didn't, he's hollering at Jesus. Well, the other thief was for a while, too. He was casting aspersions of Jesus while he's on the cross.
Yeah.
And after the other one thief repented, the other one said, if thou can do anything, save us.
Mm-hmm.
Say, take us down from here. This is what your old nature is doing. If you're in Christ, your old nature is crying this out all the time. Let me off this cross. Give me some breathing room. Give me some space.
Yeah,
Let me do something. At least once in a while, let me do something.
Yeah.
You'll find out. If the old man's ever off the cross, he's just as strong as he's ever been.
Yes, amen.
He hasn't lost one millimeter of strength.
Yeah. Amen.
Now let's look. Something new is something differing in nature. That's the one to illustrate here. Something new is something differing in nature. It's a different kind. So let's see how it's used in Scripture. Exodus 1:8. Joseph, you remember, had been down in Egypt. He was in favor of Pharaoh. Exodus 1:8 says, there arose up a new king, which knew not Joseph. It's a different kind of king now. More things changed. It's a different kind of king. Things changed. He didn't know Joseph. See, new means different kind. Again, Numbers 16:30. If the Lord make a new thing and the earth open up her mouth and swallow them up with all that appertain to them and they go down into the pit, then you shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord. Aaron was chosen by God as the high priest. He was chosen out of the tribe of Levi. Under the leadership of Korah, some of the other Levites said, well, how come it was Aaron? We're Levites. Why wasn't one of us chosen? See? And so God said, I'm going to do a new thing now. I'm going to do something new. To show you that I made the right choice, I'm going to do a new thing. Here's a new thing. The earth will open up and swallow these men, 250 of them. Well, if that happened here in Joplin, I could tell you it'd make the news.
That's right.
Amen. The earth opened up and, see, there was a rock concert going on. A lot of boozing and things like that. Uh-huh. All of a sudden, the earth opened up and swallowed them all. It'd make the news.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why? Because it was new. It was a different kind of different kind of thing. Here it is again, Psalm 33:3. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Different kind of song. Don't just sing by rote. Don't come before the Lord and think you're singing before the Lord's going to change you.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
this is taught now.
Yes.
Keep in mind, this stuff is taught.
Mm-hmm.
Your singing doesn't change you.
Mm-hmm.
Can't change a wayward heart. You can take a drunk and you can teach him to sing beautiful songs.
Mm-hmm.
It won't take away.
That's right.
What he is. You got to sing a new song.
Amen.
Song of praise, thanking God for what he did, not what you want him to do. See, it's all the difference in the world.
Amen.
Isaiah 43:13. Behold, I'll do a new thing. It shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will make a way in the wilderness. I'll make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. That's a new kind of that's a new kind of thing. Highway in the desert, river, highway in the wilderness, river in the desert. See, that's a different kind of, it's a different kind of desert that has a river flowing through it. That's a different kind of desert.
Yeah.
A highway through a wilderness, that's a different kind of, that's a different kind of wilderness.
Yeah.
See, a new kind. Mm. Isaiah 65:17, behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. And the former shall not be remembered, nor come into mind. See, it's a different kind of heavens, a different kind of earth. And it'll be so grand you won't even remember the former one. But it won't come to it. Thank God, I'm looking forward to that.
Amen.
You ever thought how many times you remember stuff you don't want to remember?
Yes.
It's going to all end now in the new heavens and new earth.
Amen.
For those in Christ, at any rate. Ezekiel 11:19. Remember, I'm commenting on the new kind. I will give them one heart. That's they'll all think the same way. And I'll put a new spirit within you. I'll take the stony heart out of their flesh. I'll give them a heart of flesh that they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and do them. And they shall be my people and I'll be their God. It's a new kind of heart. I won't have to tell them. Seek me. I mean, you have to be told that.
Yeah.
We don't say you're lost. We say you're a baby.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
If you have to be told, don't sin. Read it in the Bible who was told this.
Yeah.
It's people that were being rebuked for sinning.
Uh-huh.
Read it. See it. So I'll give you a new heart. You won't have to be told what to do and what not to do.
Uh-huh.
If you listen to your conscience and listen to your heart, you'll be guided from within.
Amen.
Not from without. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Creation is the idea. New creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, either this happens when you come into Christ or it doesn't.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, I'm affirming it does. When you come into Christ, you become a new kind of person.
Right.
Old things pass away in the sense they don't dominate you anymore. And people that teach they do are liars.
Amen.
Amen.
They need to be called this, called publicly.
Yeah.
You can't come into Jesus and stay the way you were.
Amen. That's right.
And this is being taught now.
Yeah.
This is being taught. People get upset with me when I speak this way, but I'm going to pick it up. I'm not going to lay it down. I'm going to pick it up. I'm going to say it stronger.
Uh-huh.
He is a new creation. Old things pass away. They lost their dominance. They don't rule you anymore.
Yeah.
Everything's become new. See? We're talking about the new covenant. This is whatever. It's a new kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, who told the early church to go everywhere preaching the word? Says as many as were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Who told them to do that? You see, well, Jesus said preach the gospel to everyone, so they must have passed that on. Is that right? Well, where exactly does it say that? You couldn't stop these people from speaking.
Amen.
Everywhere they went, they testified because it was something within. They were compelled from within. Law compels from without. All law compels from without. It holds out a penalty if you don't do it. Now, God, now, notice how this works. God offers you a reward if you do it, and that the incentive of that reward, you'll seek a city that has foundations whose builder and maker is God. It doesn't make any difference what comes your way, what discouraging things come your way. You still keep on pressing toward the mark because you're driven by another principle. Again, Hebrews 10:20. A new and a living way which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say his flesh. So Jesus has raised up a new kind of approach to God. It's not do this and that and you can come in. That's how it was under the law. Go out first before you do anything. Priests, go out first and wash in the laver. You wash the laver, put on your special clothes. These are all external things. Put on your special clothes. Go inside the tabernacle. Don't be fooling around when you go in there or I'll strike you dead. Keep that lamp candlestick. Keep it lit. Don't let one day pass where that candlestick's not burning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Make sure every week there's fresh bread put on that table of showbread.
Yeah.
Every day burn some incense in there so it smells pleasant in here.
Yeah.
Don't anybody go beyond that veil. See? He gave them rules. And the penalty, if you violated that, you were just, God killed you.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Lest he die. You just read how many times this is stated.
Yeah.
Now, it's a new and living way. You don't come to God by a routine.
Yeah.
You come by faith.
Amen.
You have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand to rejoice and hope of the glory of God. You've got access to God with confidence. This is what happens when under the new covenant. This is why, when you sin, and as Paul would say, these things I write unto you that you sin not. John said, that's why I'm writing, so you won't sin.
Yeah, amen.
But if anybody does, we have an advocate with the Father. Then he tells you, you confess your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive your sin. So you got to address that sin. Amen. You can't go to some group that says, it's tough to overcome this. Let's all meet together and talk about it. Sounds smart, huh? It ain't working. Alcoholics Anonymous could tell us it doesn't work. Some of these people quit drinking 50 years ago, and they still have this driving compulsion to drink. They got to go to these special meetings to keep it down. But notice the difference when you come into Christ. Rather than all your lifetime being spent subduing, you are pressing into the mark.
Amen.
You're doing things you never did before. You're seeking the Lord. Nobody can stop that. Yes. See, you're compelled by a different. The new covenant is a different kind of covenant. Gives you a new heart, new desire, where you actually are aggressively seeking to serve God rather than aggressively seeking to not displease Him. That's what you were doing, everything you can, not to provoke God. And even some did in spite of the fact. Did. Different principle. Then Peter said, we according to his promise look for a new heavens and a new earth. Wherein dwells righteousness. Oh, that's a different kind of heavens and earth. Heavens mean the created heavens, not the heaven where the throne of God is. Righteousness is going to dwell in that new heavens and new earth. There isn't going to be any law against anything. When you come into Christ, the fruit of the Spirit against such, there's no law. No one's sitting to look. Brother Tony, you've been loving people too much now. It's going a little bit too far. Just a Melissa, you've been having too much mercy. See, against such there's no law. But the law was always dealing with excesses. Trying to throttle it down, see. But we have a new covenant. It's a different kind of covenant. Now there's several references to the new covenant in Scripture. It was a promised covenant. I don't think I'm wrong on this, but I'll venture out. I don't think the law was promised. It was given. But I don't think it was promised. But the new covenant was promised.
Amen.
I will make a new covenant. Why? Because I've shown you that the old covenant, it was never meant to stop sin. It was meant to teach people how to identify sin. The scripture says, by the law is a knowledge of sin. So it taught you what sin was, but it didn't give you any resources to combat it. Now, Jesus first mentioned the covenant on the night he was betrayed. The first time he ever mentioned anything about it. That's how new this thing was. Uh-huh. See, you couldn't talk about the new covenant to people living under the... So it was just to a select group. He talked about a new covenant, said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. That was the first time he ever talked about the New Testament. New covenant. Didn't talk about it up until then. Then he did. He mentioned it was new. And Paul said that Jesus personally taught him about the Lord's Supper. In 1 Corinthians 11:25, he said, this is the New Testament in my blood. This is the first time Jesus mentioned anything about the New Testament. Jesus never told the disciples, I'm going to give everybody a new covenant. See, he didn't just totally end, because the old covenant wasn't going to end until Christ's sacrifice was completed. And in that he made a new covenant, he had made the first old. So as soon as the new covenant came, the previous covenant became old. That is, it became decrepit. And its end was right around the corner. Now you'll notice that the only writer in scripture, in the New Covenant scriptures that talked about the covenant was Paul. Nobody else talked about the covenant. Read it and see. Nobody else talked about the covenant. None of the epistles addressed, but Paul's writings did address the covenant. I could mention some of these. Surely you're familiar. Mm-hmm. You're familiar with it. He said, we're ministers of the new covenant. Uh-huh. 2 Corinthians 3:6. He said that's a mediator of the new covenant, as a mediator. Jesus Christ is the mediator of the new covenant. Hebrews 9:15 and Hebrews 12:24. But only Paul, I want to stress this, only Paul mentioned the new covenant. Peter and John mentioned the blood of Christ as having to do with our redemption. They did, but they didn't call it the blood of the covenant. But they did mention the blood of Christ. Here's some things that Paul said. Romans 11:27, talking about Israel as a whole having their sins remitted and the veil being lifted from their eyes. He says, this is my covenant with them. You talk about the offspring of Abraham. Someone say, well, but they weren't all Israel. That's not the argument he's using here, brethren.
Yeah.
When he talks about this, that's not the language he uses.
Uh-huh.
Talk about as a people. We understand that it won't, I'm not sure how many it's going to be. I'm not sure. Even the remnant of the people. That can't be who he's talking about. He can't talk about he's going to turn away sin from the people that are in. I mean, this is absurd.
Right.
This is what he's talking about.
Uh-huh.
He made a covenant with Abraham concerning his offspring. He didn't give any qualifiers when he said it.
Huh? Right.
Now, this may be difficult to be, for us to receive, but you got to take it like it's stated.
Amen.
This is my covenant to them when I take away their sin.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I don't know that it ever says he takes away the sin of the remnant. Now, you'll have to, you'll have to confirm it yourself, but I don't think it's ever said that way. That's my covenant to them. That's the point I'm making. That's my covenant with them. Brethren, I speak, Galatians 3:15, unless a covenant is confirmed, if a covenant is confirmed, no man disannuls it or abrogates it. Galatians 4:24, which things are an allegory, Sarah and Hagar, which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants, the one from Sinai, which ends with the bonds, which is Hagar, then Jerusalem, which is above. See, he's talking about the covenant, but he's the only one that talks about the covenant. Ephesians 2:12, at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise. Hebrews 8:6, Christ has obtained a more excellent ministry as he is the mediator of the new covenant. And several others, I won't go into at this time. But here, I wanted to make a point that the Gentiles were given the lead on this. Paul's apostle to the Gentiles, and he gave a gospel to them that, so far as we know, nobody else received exactly like this.
Amen.
Even the people to whom the promise was made.
Yes.
See, Israel received the promise, I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, saith the Lord. I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
Paul's the only one that says it's been done. He's done it. The covenant's been made.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, he says, I'm going to fulfill it to Israel.
Amen. That's right.
That's my covenant with them
when
I take away their sin.
Yeah.
And that's the text which says, the gifts and callings of God are without repentance.
Amen.
That's the promise he's referring to, what he promised Abraham.
Yes.
He said, I'm going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like it's impossible. It looks like the odds are against this. It looks like things are stacked against this.
Mm-hmm.
But he's going to do this just as surely as he brought you in the covenant. He's going to bring them in.
Amen. Amen.
And it's going to be the exception
if
some of them aren't in.
Mm-hmm.
Not going to be the rule. It's going to be the exception.
Yeah.
It was not that there are going to be 10 billion people in 100 get in. I mean, it's not, that's not how this is stated.
Mm-hmm.
When the new comes, the old passes away. See, a new covenant, the new covenant cannot function within the framework of the old covenant. You can take all the good things God has promised in Christ and try and apply them in the framework of the old covenant, and it'd be like putting new wine in old wineskins. It doesn't work. Newness of life can't work by rules. Yeah, well, we got to have rules for when they come in. That's right. When they're children, you're right. As long as we're children, we're under tutors and governors. That's what Galatians tells us. We're under tutors and that's Christian people. As long as they're children. But God expects them to get out of that state. Now, I personally know more people than I care to count at this present time that have been babies for 40 and 50 and 60 years. They've never grown up. This is wrong. This is a violation of what God said he was going to do. Don't be children in understanding. That's 1 Corinthians 14:20. Don't be children in understanding, but in understanding, be men. Why? Because you don't get the good stuff until you do.
Yes, amen.
Until you can understand, you don't get the precious, the riches of the grace of God. That, I'm sorry. You'll get forgiveness, I know that, but you got to have more than forgiveness. You want fellowship with Christ, you're called into fellowship with Christ, and that's a notch above forgiveness, let me tell you. You've got to have the forgiveness to get that. But the aim is to be conversant with Christ. To be able to sit under Christ and know what he's talking about. To have fellowship with the Father, as 1 John 1:3 says. To be able to come to God, to read your Bible and know what it's talking about. That's the aim. That's what the new covenant.
Yes.
That's what it does. When the new covenant comes, the old passes away.
Amen.
As I've said, the Ten Commandments, for all practical purposes, become ten promises. You read those commandments when you're in the. You got to do this when you're in the Spirit. You'll say, "Now thou shalt. You're not going to have any other gods before me." That's fulfilled in Christ. The righteous. No, but this isn't a mystery. Romans 8:4 says, the righteousness of the law is fulfilled in the righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. And the preceding verse is what the law could not do. And that it was weak through the flesh. That's our flesh. The law required more than man could give.
Yeah, that's right.
But God never told men you can't do it. Men are saying this all the time. They say, look, nobody can keep the law. You can't buttress that with a word from God. I challenge you to do it. Buttress that with a word from God, where God said no man can keep the law. That's the way it worked out. I understand it's the way it worked out, but God, that's not what God said. Because if he said that, nobody'd try to do it. You should see this. People should see this without being told. The law stated that you can't ignore what it says. You've got to extend yourself, and you've got to find out by experience, not by teaching. You've got to find out by experience, I'm not able to do everything God said to do, and the law says I'm going to be condemned if I don't, so I need something else.
Amen.
Now enters the Savior.
Amen.
Says, come to me, all ye that weary and heavy laden.
Amen.
Take my yoke. You couldn't stand the yoke of the law, could you? I'll take my yoke upon you and learn from me. You'll find rest.
Amen.
What did he mean, take my yoke? Because he's in the other side of the yoke. See, a yoke takes two, and they pull together. So one's you, and that's probably a very small yoke. But the other, Jesus, is the other.
Amen.
He's pulling the weight of the burden. It's not I that live, but Christ that lives in me. See, that's what he was telling. That's a commentary on what it means that my yoke is easy. As long as you're pulling with Jesus, yes, this is it, which is easy. Even though you have to fight and struggle and run and so forth, it's still easy because you're in the yoke of Jesus. But if you're in the yoke by yourself, which the law does, he just yokes you up by yourself. And you got to pull everything. You got to do everything that's required. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. When the new comes, the old passes away. Now, when the new heavens and new earth come, Peter said, looking for and hasting unto, that is, we're running toward that. Yes. Hasten to the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens, a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. So see, when the new heavens and earth come in, the old go out.
Yeah.
When you're born again, old things go out. Mm-hmm. New things come in. See, that's when the new comes in, we throw away the old wines. We got to have new wine skins to hold this new wine.
Amen.
The law was the law wasn't the covenant. It was the words of the covenant. And I think I've made this point several times in this series of messages because I was raised up under the misconception, I exclude my father from this, under the misconception that the law was the covenant. But it was the words of the covenant. Yeah, the
right.
Covenant was, this will we do.
Yeah, right.
That was the covenant. And it wasn't, we'll try and do. This we will do. And he told Moses all the words that he had said. We will. That was the covenant. You are not going to be saved, dearly beloved brothers and sisters. You are not going to be saved by agreeing to do everything God tells you to do. It's by grace through faith that we're saved. You've got to believe that for God to be pleased, Jesus and Jesus alone did what was necessary to please God to the extent that he would justify sinners.
Yes.
That's a new covenant. That's a different kind of covenant. Now, the first covenant was a figure. I want you to notice in closing how precise the language is on this. Hebrews 9:9-10. The reason why is the law made nothing perfect. We'd say no one perfect. See, the law wasn't a worker that made enabled you to measure up. The law didn't come with that kind of resource. It just came with the requirements, but it had no. It conferred no ability. There wasn't grace that accompanied law that helped you do what he said to do. This is how law works. Even the world's law, when law passes an ordinance of a law, they don't pass in a lot of helps to help you keep it. That's not the way law works. Hebrews 9:9-10, the law, which was a figure for the time then present. Just the law was not intended to be like an eternal means that you always had to go through the law to get to Christ. This, it was for a figure for the time then. It was a picture. It wasn't the real thing. It was a picture, like having a picture of an apple that prepared you for the apple. It was a figure for the time then present. In which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, and there were thousands of them. Thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions. The amount of blood shed is staggering.
Yeah.
Just at the temple, there were 20,000 sheep. Just at the dedication of the temple alone, 20,000 sheep and several thousand cattle. In which were both offered gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect. Him that did the service, the high priest. They couldn't make him perfect pertaining to the conscience. So the people didn't offer these sacrifices. It was the high priest that offered them, and priests that offered them. And the high priest, he'd offer first for himself, he'd offer sacrifices for himself because he wasn't perfect, and then the sins of the people. But those sacrifices never purged the conscience of the people. The Day of Atonement, which was a peak day under the law, and what happened during that time, people remembered not that they were forgiven, they remembered their sin.
That's right.
Through these, this is Hebrews 10:3, a remembrance was made of sin. So under the law, the closer you got to God, the more you remembered your sin. The more exacting your obedience was to the Lord, the more precisely you remembered your sin. But this is not the way it is in Christ.
Amen.
Some of us have terrible backgrounds. We're ashamed of them.
Yeah.
We don't want to talk about them. But when I draw near to God, let me tell you, that's not what I remember.
Amen.
There's times when you have to remember what you are, what you were. I understand that. We don't like blot this from our memory.
Uh-huh.
But as you draw close to God, He shows you what you are,
yes,
not what you were.
Yes.
And what produces the praise is what you are.
Amen. Amen.
These that were only for the time present stood or were carried out in meats and drinks. The Lord told you what to eat. You had to obey Him when He told you what to eat. Don't eat this, eat that. See, what was that for? Because God was teaching people good dietary practices? You know, people that say this, we don't need them in the body of Christ. We don't need people like this. The reason was God was teaching people, before I can save, you got to learn that you've got to do what I say.
Yes, yeah.
And when about the time you want to do what He says, but you find you're not getting it done, then now you're ready for Christ.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Now you're ready for Christ. They stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings. Carnal ordinances are external procedures imposed on them until the time of reformation.
Uh-huh.
Reforming. Not reform as in reform criminal, reshape.
Yeah, yeah.
The time of reformation is a new covenant. And under the new covenant, ordinances are not imposed. The Bible says, for instance, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together.
Uh-huh.
It is already happening, as the manner of some is. Of course, that has to be said a lot today because so many people do forsake the assembling of themselves together. But as soon as people are living by faith, you don't have to tell them this.
That's right.
Yeah. The early church, they continued to fellowship in the temple and from house to house. They didn't get enough in the temple. They would go to meet in house to house. They met in the temple. They had temple courts that could see. He could handle thousands of people in one of these courts. They met every day now. They couldn't get enough. They couldn't get enough of this. You won't either.
Yeah, amen.
You won't be able to get enough of this. You'll be compelled from within, see? Your wanter is changed, and the law can't change a wanter, even if it threatens you with stoning. Well, that must be a terrible death, stoning. Some nations still practice it. It's a brutal death.
Yeah.
Even it threatened with stoning, it still couldn't put a cap on sin. It still couldn't do it. Why? Because sin's not stopped that way.
That's right. Yeah.
Because sin is your essential nature that moving you to sin. It's what you are that moves you to sin. See? So then God in the new covenant changes who you are and what you are. He makes you a new creation. And I can tell you, everyone that is baptized into Christ never comes out of the water saying, what sin can I do now? I mean, it's...
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
No one that I know ever did do that. I never heard of such a thing. Uh-huh. Unless it was a person who just was acting.
Mm-hmm.
And that's your personal commentary on the effectiveness of the coming of the new.
Yeah.
All right, I think I'll close there.
Amen.
Brother Gene has our exhortation.